Okay, in this video I want to talk about really what is the heart of an SSB transceiver or superhet receiver, and that's the crystal filter. So for this Mythbuster transceiver, I have the 9 megahertz VFO from the FT-101 that I bought at Pete Giuliano's suggestion. And then I realized, okay, I need a filter at 5.2 megahertz. Mauser has some crystals on sale, really cheap, for 5.242, which is close enough. So I bought 20 of them, and then I did a quick check to get 10 that are closest in frequency, because I wanted to make a 10-pole filter. This might seem excessive, but what I wanted to do is I wanted to try to get as close as possible to the vertical skirt walls that you see on the SDR transceivers that people are so proud of. You know, our crystal filters are normally, you know, like 4 poles or something like that, and the skirts are kind of quite wide. And then you go onto the web SDR receivers and you see these guys who are running obviously with skirts that are near vertical. So I started to fool around with some of the crystal filter design software, Dishal, which is quite good, the AADE software, which is quite good. And I came up with the idea of maybe I'll build a 10-pole filter. So I picked out the 10 crystals. I used AADE and Dishal to try to determine what the capacitance would be, what the capacitors to ground between the different crystals would be. This I'm using minimum loss cone topology, which has an advantage in that all of the capacitors are the same value. So I started fooling around with different values, and I started placing orders to Mauser for different values of capacitors. And I started out with one that was actually quite high. I think it was like 56 picofarad. That resulted in a filter that was too narrow. So then I went down from, where did I start? I have the envelopes here. Yeah, I started at 56. That was too high. Then I went down to 47. That was better. And so at 47, still kind of narrow. And at 47, the bandwidth was about 2.6 kcs, which is a little bit narrow. So I have actually purchased, and I have here standing by if I need them, 36 picofarad capacitors. But I haven't gone in to replace them yet because I think 2.6, it might be doable. However, if I get the thing built and I decide, man, I need a wider filter, I'll pull out these caps and put them in. It doesn't take too long to change 10 or 12 caps in on one of these boards. Just unsolder them and solder in the new ones. Anyway, that's the filter. Now, on the ends, I have termination insensitive amplifiers. And these are based on the 2009 article by Wes Hayward and Bob Kopchi. Really, really a good article. And it describes why you would need termination insensitive amplifiers. Here's the problem. It's really important that you get the impedances on both ends of the filter correct. And because this is bidirectional, it's going to be received this way, transmit this way, the amplifiers on both ends have to be what's called termination insensitive. Because if you don't have a termination insensitive amplifier, the impedance at this point going into the filter will be affected by whatever you hang off on this end. And so you could get into a really kind of crazy situation where you design for a certain impedance, then you hang something else off here, which changes the impedance up here, which changes, and then it changes when you go in one direction or the other direction. Better to use termination insensitive amplifiers, and that's what I've done here. The Dishal and the AADE software indicated that this filter would have a kind of a characteristic impedance of, I think, around 560, 580 ohms. And the termination insensitive amplifiers are 50 ohms. So I needed a transformer. So I built two little transformers here on FT37-43 material. I think the turns ratio are it's like 14 to 4, 4 being the 50 ohms and 14 being the 500 ohms. That gives you a proper match. And then you could take a look at what the passband looks like on the on either. I have an Antuino here, and I have a Nano VNA here also. And I have pictures of what the passband looks like, so I won't belabor the point by hooking it all up here. But it is very useful when you try to determine, those devices are very useful when you try to determine what the passband looks like, whether the ripple in the passband is acceptable or not, and just to make sure that you've got everything working properly. I measured it, I think I have about 35 dB end-to-end, including about 5 or 6 dB insertion loss in the filter. And again, it's about 2.6 KC's wide. The skirts are quite steep, so I may be able to fool some guys into thinking that I'm running an SDR kind of transceiver. What else to mention here? I think that's about it. One other thing I did want to mention, that, you know, one of the things, because I have the NanoVNA, and here it is, the NanoVNA, this is such a promising device in that it has a Smith chart in it. It basically has an SDR receiver in it and transmitter, and this allows you to measure not just amplitudes but phase differences. That's how it comes up with a Smith chart on the screen. And what you could do with this thing, theoretically, is hook it up and check and measure the input impedance and the output or look-back impedance on amplifiers. Now, I know these amplifiers are 50 ohms because that's what Wes Hayward, Bob Kopchi's article said. But I just wanted to make sure that I'm using the Nano VNA correctly. So I hooked up these little connectors here on the end, you can see here, to plug the Nano VNA in to check and see if indeed they're measuring 50 ohms. Now, I'm not doubting Wes Hayward's work here. What I'm trying to check on is my ability to use the Nano VNA to get it to measure and show 50 ohms. Now, I had a lot of trouble with this because even though I knew it was 50 ohms, I can confirm that it was 50 ohms because when I checked the SWR with the Antuino, it showed a 1-to-1 SWR indicating 50 ohms. So, but I wasn't getting 50 ohms on the Nano VNA. So I've done some head scratching and some consultations with Farhan and with Alan Wolke, W2AEW. And I think we've come up with an explanation of what went wrong. Alan, I think, is going to make a video about this, about how to use the Nano VNA to measure input and output impedances on amplifiers. I think this is quite important for homebrewers like me, who are always sort of taking bits and pieces of circuitry from different rigs and trying to combine them, as I'm doing here. When you do this, you really need a way to check input and output impedances, especially if you're dealing with circuits that aren't as well documented as the termination insensitive amplifiers. And so I think that this use of the Nano VNA will be a game changer in many ways for home brewers, certainly home brewers like me, who are always sort of just collecting bits and pieces of circuitry and putting them together and hope they work properly. That the impedance measurements has always been a little bit difficult for me. LT Spice gives you a way to sort of find out if you're in the ballpark, because there are ways with LT Spice that you could build the circuit in LT Spice and then try to check the impedance going in and going back out, the input and output impedances using LT Spice. But I don't know, I just like the idea of being able to take the Nano VNA, pop it in there, take a look at the Smith chart, and know that that is the, in fact, input impedance of the device, or the output impedance of the device that I'm working on. All right. So I think next time I'll talk a little bit about the BFO, or the VFO that out of the FT-101 that'll go into the Mythbuster. Okay, that's it for now. 7-3.